Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Welcome to a new session of Social Science Children. We are just going to see a new lesson in our civics. Right? So let us see what is that lesson. This is going to be an interesting lesson, children. We will see what are the institutional representation of democracy. So we know what is democracy. What is democracy? Democracy is a government of the people, by the people and for the people, right? It is a government of the people by the people and for the people. Okay, so that is the form of democratic government. So what are all the institutions there in the democracy to ensure people are given equality? We are going to see about that in this lesson. All right, so we will go into the lesson. So we know that there are various values for democracy like liberty, equality, justice, diversity and sovereignty. So everyone should be treated equally in spite of their caste, creed, religion, gender, whatever difference can be, but everyone has to be treated. Everyone is equal before the eyes of the law. So that is the basic concept of democracy. So the person can be rich, person can be poor, but the treatment is equal before the eyes of the law. So if a person is going to commit a mistake, if he is a poor or if he is a rich person, government or the law will never mind about that. It should punish them in spite of their difference, right? So everyone has to be treated equally. Everyone has to be given freedom. Liberty is nothing but giving freedom to do whatever they want in a right way. Okay, so nothing unlawful will be permitted, but anything that has to be done or a person wishes to do, he has to be given the right to do that. And then justice. So as I said, law, that comes under this justice. So everyone will be treated equally. A person committing a mistake, yes, he has committed a mistake. So that is how we will be seeing. And diversity, we all know that diversity is the difference or the discrimination based on the caste, religion and everything. So in spite of all those differences, everyone will be treated equally. The basic concept is everyone is treated equally, everyone gets whatever they want, the basic needs, and everyone has the freedom to do any right thing, right? So that is all about the democracy. So these are all the values of democracy. So government or the leaders of the democratic form of government should ensure that these values are reaching everyone. These values are followed throughout the country. So what is being done to follow all these? So it is done through certain institutions and processes. So there are some processes we follow. There are some steps we follow. There are some organization for this itself to make sure that everyone can uphold these values, right? So let us see what are all those organizations. First comes universal adult franchise, then it is elections, after that comes political parties, and the last one is coalition government, right? So first, universal adult franchise. So we all know what is universal adult franchise. It is all about the right to vote. So who will be given the right to vote? Now, after our country became independent in 1947 and after the Constitution of India was written, any Indian citizen who has completed 18 years of age will be given the right to vote. So before that, it was not like that. No one was given the right. That is, only the rich people or only the people with more money, right? People who were wealthy. Or women were not given the right to vote. Then the people of different caste or religion, that is people who were considered to be the lower caste, okay, they were not given the right to vote. But it all changed after the Constitution of India. So we will first see about universal adult franchise. So, universal adult franchise is nothing but about the voting. So, we will see what it is. So, every Indian citizen who have completed 18 years of age, okay, so after completion of 18 years, so after completion of 18 years, the citizen is said to be an adult. Okay, so every adult citizen has the right to vote, and this right was granted by the Constitution of India. So when was this Constitution of India enacted? It was enacted in 1950. Right? So any Indian citizen, in spite of any religion, any caste, any community, any gender, whatever may be, whatever the economic status is, he will be given the right to vote. So here you can see this universal adult suffrage has been granted to all the adult citizens. So they can be from any religion, any caste, any economic status or any gender. They will be given the right to vote. What is meant by suffrage? Suffrage means right to vote. Right? Suffrage means right to vote. Okay, next. So there are some people again whom we do not give the right to vote. Okay, so they will not be given right to vote. Who are they? People who are of unsound mind. So people who are not steady by their mind, they will not be given the right to vote. So which means people who have mental sickness, right? So they will not be given the right to vote. And those people who have been punished by the court of law. Okay, so anybody who have been punished by the court of law for any unlawful activity, be it a criminal activity. Okay, so they will not be given the right to vote. So here you can see people of unsound mind and people who have been convicted by the court of law for any criminal offense alone do not have the right to vote. So they will not be given any rights to vote. Then what are all the other things which we have to know about voting? So each person on an election can give only one vote. So it is only one vote for one person. One person cannot give multiple votes. Okay, then the value of every vote is the same. So everyone is going to put their vote, everyone is going to cast their vote, and the value for each and every vote is going to be the same, and it is not going to vary. Through this institution of universal adult franchise, every citizen of India is equally empowered. So everyone is given the right to vote, which means we have the right to choose who is going to rule us, right? So based on our decision, a ruler is coming, that is a leader is going to take care of us. So we are representing a person from ourselves to take care of us. So that is about democracy, and that is how each and every citizen will be given power in a democratic country, right? And it is a cornerstone in Indian democracy. So it is a very important milestone in Indian democracy, because previously the difference is under difference in thoughts, as well as the just setting apart the people based on the caste, religion and everything was very much painful. That is, people were suffering a lot. People of lower caste were suffering a lot. People from people, especially women, were suffering a lot. So this turned out to be a very important milestone in Indian democracy, right? So here you can see the first phase of election in 1952. This was the first election happened in 1952. You can see a very old man was even carried by his maybe his family members to cast his vote. So that is how the elections happened first. Okay, so everyone were given the rights to vote. So previously, these people would not have given not been given any rights. So when they got all their rights, everyone did their duties perfectly. Right? And again, after this 1950 Indian Constitution only, even women were given the right to vote. So first, the hope you all remember the lesson which you would have studied in your 6th standard. First, women were not given right to vote throughout the world. Then what happened? Many people started protesting against this. Many people fought for this. And first country to give right to vote for women was New Zealand in 1893. Then followed by US in 1920 and UK in 1928. And in India, it was in 1950. So women were also given the right to vote. So now, what we are going to see? It is about elections. So what is an election? It is the process by which we choose our representative to rule the country or to take care of the government, right? So in India, it is an indirect or representative democracy. What is meant by indirect or representative democracy? It is not possible for each and every one of us to go and rule the government, go and rule the country, right? So what do? We choose one person among us, representing us, and he will take care of us. So we choose our leader for taking care of us, right? So we do not participate directly, but we choose the person who is going to participate on behalf of us, right? That is called as representative democracy. So this process of selecting our representatives to run the government of a country or a state, okay, so this process of selecting the leader is called as election, right? So now, what are the two types of elections? So there are two types of elections in our country. First one is the general election and the second one is the state assembly election. So first comes the general election, which happens for central government. Okay, so the general election is for central government. The same way, the state assembly election is for state government. So, as we all know, elections happen once in every 5 years. So, for central government, once the rule starts, after 5 years, the election will come. The same way for state government also. So, this happens once in 5 years. But there are situations where the election will happen in between also. Maybe if it is going to be an emergency situation. So, if it is going to be an emergency situation like a war, okay, so then comes election even in between. That is, we will not wait for that 5 years to complete. If any emergency situation comes, we will take up the election in between also. So the general election, the representatives are elected to the Lok Sabha or the central government. So the general election is for Lok Sabha or central government. Then what about state elections? The representatives are selected for state legislative assemblies. Okay, so the state legislative assemblies or the state government. So this state assembly election and general election, we choose our representatives. Then what is a constituency? So what is meant by constituency? Elections happen, okay, so where does it happen? On what basis does this happen? We are going to see about that. So first comes constituency. So what is meant by a constituency? The country is divided into smaller parts, okay? The country is divided into smaller parts for the purpose of election. So one person cannot take care, just only one person cannot take care of the entire state. So we divide the state into various parts for choosing one representative from each part against that particular area. Okay, so the country is divided into a number of smaller units for the purpose of election and it is called as constituency. So on what basis this constituency is divided? This is divided purely based on the population. Okay? So they divide it in such a way that the number of people in one constituency is more or less equal to the other constituencies. So the population matches in various constituencies. Okay? So somehow it there should not be much difference in the population. So that is how the constituency is being divided. So here you can see they are created on the basis of population, such that the number of people in each constituency will be equal. So population is the main basis for calculating or splitting up the constituencies. Okay, so on this constituency division, we have it is separate for the country, the constituencies for the country is separate, and the constituency for the state itself is separate. Okay, that is not the same for both. So here you can see each constituency votes and selects their representative to the government. So for our particular constituency, we choose our representative who will be there for us, who will be working for our constituency, right? And there is one set of constituency for Lok Sabha elections. The same way, there is another set of constituency for state legislative assembly elections. Okay? So, do you know about how many constituencies are there in our country? So, when it is a central election, okay, when it is going to be Lok Sabha election, we have 543 constituencies. Okay, so when it is central government election, it is 543 constituencies, and when it is state government election, it is 234 constituencies for Tamil Nadu. Okay, not all the states are equal in the number of constituencies. For Tamil Nadu, it is 234 constituencies. So next, we are going to see about reserved constituencies. So what is meant by reserved constituencies? So here, there are some constituencies which are reserved for a particular community. Okay, so in that constituency, only that community or caste person alone can contest for election. Okay, so no other caste people will be permitted to contest in that constituency. Clear? So this constituencies which are reserved for certain communities are called as reserved constituencies. So this reservation is usually done for, so for whom all these reservation being given? Usually for the people from scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, or Anglo-Indian. So they will be given this privilege of reserved constituency. So why is this reservation being given? Because these people have been treated as lower caste from the beginning, so that now the government ensures that no particular caste will be left over without a leader. So everyone, all the groups are included in the assembly. All the caste or all the religion people are included in the Lok Sabha. Government is ensuring that, right? So only people from a particular caste whom the constituency has been reserved can contest in elections and hold seats. So if a particular constituency is reserved for a scheduled caste candidate, only a scheduled caste candidate can compete in that constituency. Any other caste person will not be permitted. Clear? Then, this has been done so that the legislative body will include representatives from all groups of society. So, just to ensure that the government has people from all groups, the government is having the people who can represent each and every group of the country, this policy is there. Right, then we are going to see about Election Commission of India. So we have seen what is election, then we have seen how the places are divided as constituencies. So now, who is taking care of these election activities? Okay, so we are going to see about that. So that is Election Commission of India. We call it as Nirvachan Sadhan in India, right? So this Election Commission of India is the sole authority. Sole authority means only authority who decides upon all the matters relating to election. Okay, So it is conducted by election commission. So the elections in India, whatever it can be a central election or it can be a state election, it is conducted by the election commission of India. Then it is an independent body. Then it ensures that elections are conducted in a free and fair manner, which means there should not be any partiality for any particular candidate. Every candidate who is going to compete in the election should be given equal rights or equal duties. So everyone has to be treated equally. So whatever caste may be, from wherever the person can come, the candidate will be there. But government or this election commission has to ensure that everyone will be treated in the equal way. It also makes sure that no candidate gets an unfair advantage. So no particular candidate can be given any special advantage for any reason, right? So even if the person is going to be maybe a relative for a person working in the election commission, okay, let it be like that. So if a person working in the election commission and his relative is going to contest in the election, he cannot give any special permission to that candidate alone. He is not supposed to do that. Everyone has to be treated equally. So that is the main goal of this election commission. And the election commission is in charge of the entire election process. So what are all the election processes? What does the process mean? First, they will decide that the elections are going to be conducted. That will be the first thing. So the election commission will declare that yes, so and so election is going to happen. That is the first step. Then they will decide on dates. Then they will decide on nomination filing. Then it will decide. Anyway, we are going to see about the process of election in detail in our next session. So from the declaration of election up to the counting of votes, and then up to the announcement of results, the entire activity is carried by the election commission. So starting from declaration of elections till the counting of votes and finally the announcement of results, so everything is being done by the election commission. So it is defined with a set of guidelines that political parties and candidates have to follow during election. So there is a set of rules for the political parties or even the individual candidates who participate in the election, who contest in the election. Okay, so that rule is called as model code of conduct. So that has to be followed throughout the process of the election, and it comes to effect once the elections are announced. So this rule will come to effect once the elections are announced. So once the election is announced, yes, we are going to conduct the elections, then from that date, this conduct has to be followed by the political parties as well as the individuals who are going to participate in the election. Then, so this election commission of India is the sole authority, which means it has its own rules and regulations, but it is answerable to only one legal authority or only one legislative body of the country, which is Parliament. So election commission is answerable to Parliament of India, and the person who takes care of this election commission, that is the chief of this election commission, is called as the chief election commissioner. Okay, so the chief election commissioner is the head of this election commission, and he is being appointed by the president of the country. So the president of India appoints the chief election commissioner, who will be the head of this election commission, right? And the election commission has its own powers to settle any kind of disputes, any kind of problems are going to come during this process of election. Election commission can settle it by itself. Okay, so even if the problem is going to be there on election results, okay, so the election commission has all the rights, all the power to settle the dispute by itself. Then it has to treat the political parties and the candidates equally. So it has to make sure that everyone is treated equally when the during the process of election. So any political party or any individual candidate who is going to participate in the election will be treated equally during the process of election. See you soon in the next session, children. More about this lesson. Thank you. Sri Gurubhyo Namaha.